Friends, this is your host for today's show, Srihari Atluri. Welcome back to NRI Samai Weekend Show. Today we'll be talking with EAS Sarma garu, Dr. EAS Sarma garu, a former Union Energy Secretary, and he has played a lot of important roles, including Principal of Administrative Staff College of India in Hyderabad, then Secretary, Minister of Finance for Government of India, then Secretary, Minister of Power, Government of India, Principal Advisor for Planning Commission from 96 to 97, and Advisor of the Planning Commission for Energy from 89 to 94. Welcome to NRI Samai, Dr. Sarma garu.
Thank you very much.
Sir, we'll be talking about various issues today, but I want to start off by asking what you are doing. When I just called you a few minutes ago, you said you were talking with a person. Can you give us a very brief information about that?
Yeah. See, there is actually one person. His name is Alexander, and he is from Srikakulam. And he is a blind person. His wife is also blind. Now, he wants to start a school for teaching blind people, mainly tribals in that area, and also Vijayanagaram and Visakhapatnam districts. And he has literally, you know, learned everything by himself without any external help. And despite his blindness, he's in a position to operate his computer and is extremely good. And now what happened was today, some engineering college students in Visakhapatnam, about 50 of them, they formed a small NGO and they want to help the society. So I have actually brought them together, is Alexander and the engineering college students, and they are giving some monetary help for starting the school for the blind. This name of the engineering college students society is Harshita. Now, what these people have done, something very interesting, they asked this Alexander, look, from blind people's point of view, can we make some innovations? And can you suggest something? So Alexander told them that most of the software programs are English, so can you convert them to Telugu? So what the engineering college students are going to do is Harshita, they have got some computer engineers. So they are going to refer the problem to them and they'll come up with some innovative solution from the software program. So they want to bring out a number of innovative ideas because they're all engineering college students, innovative ideas which will solve the problems of the society. So this is an interesting initiative, and I have been involved in helping all these blind people in this area.
Okay, that's excellent. So blind person, instead of seeking help for himself, he's asking help to set up a school for other blind kids, and the college students are involved with him, and they want to help him too. So that's a very inspirational story right there.
Yes.
Sir, today, especially in Andhra Pradesh, people are facing power crisis. Majority of people don't have 24/7 power. Actually, several hours a day they do not have power. And I think one of the issues they are facing among several is students. It's very hard for students to study and then appear for exams because there's no electricity. But there are several other issues too. So I don't know where to start, but maybe you can help. Maybe you can help with how we got into this situation, because you are the secretary of our energy, and I guess you would know.
In fact, you know, I was member secretary of the Andhra Pradesh State Electricity Board in the past. I was also secretary of power in the state of Andhra Pradesh. Now, Andhra Pradesh is one of the better managed state electricity utilities in the country. Very, very efficient, and at one time it was a surplus state, surplus in power. But right now the state is passing through a very serious crisis. Power shortages affecting the agriculture, power shortages affecting rural industry, then industry in the other areas, plus students, as you said. Now the second kind of problem is that the price, the tariff, electricity tariff has really gone up sharply. So in a way, it's a double whammy for the people of Andhra Pradesh. Now, what are the reasons? Now, the demand for electricity in Andhra Pradesh, the peak demand, is roughly 10,000 megawatts. say the month of January, February. It may go up marginally by April, maybe about 11,000 megawatts. Now, do we have the capacity to meet this? How much of capacity is required? Now, roughly, for meeting this capacity, you must have about 14,000 megawatts. Because sometimes, you know, some of the power plants may not be functioning, but generally about 14,000 megawatts, one can comfortably meet this 10,000, 11,000 megawatts of demand every day, the peak demand. Now, surprisingly, Andhra Pradesh, the total capacity that is available with us is actually 16,000 megawatts. Now, the 16,000 megawatts actually consists of mostly thermal capacity, that is coal-based generation of the Andhra Pradesh Generation Corporation. But then some hydro generation is there, that is on the River Krishna, Srisailam and Nagarjunasagar projects. But in the recent times, the last 7 to 8 years, Andhra Pradesh has unwittingly relied more and more on gas-based generation, mostly in the private sector. Today, we have got about 2,495 megawatts of gas-based generation with these private companies. Now, normally, this 16,000 megawatts would have been more than enough for meeting the demand. But unfortunately, there has been a very severe gas shortage. Now, this gas, natural gas, this Andhra Pradesh power station should come from Krishna Godavari Basin, where Reliance company is actually operating. Now, when Reliance actually announced gas discovery some years ago, they assured the government, that is the central government, the Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas, that they have got about 10 trillion cubic feet of gas deposits, and they'll be able to produce about 80 million cubic meters per day of gas every day. And so on that basis, many private companies in Andhra Pradesh went ahead and made investments in setting up this 2,500 megawatts of capacity. Now, today the position is the deposits are almost one-fifth lower than what was originally expected, and the daily production, which was assured at 80 million cubic meters per day, it has now come down to 29 and 25 even. Okay, this is one part of it. There is a general shortage of gas. But again, unfortunately, most of this gas from Krishna Godavari Basin is being piped out of Andhra Pradesh to Maharashtra and other states. And for some reason, the Andhra Pradesh government also allowed this. So, added compounding this problem of shortage of gas, this gas is being diverted to other states. So, the result is that severe cuts in gas availability for this 2,500 megawatts. So, this has really caused a very serious shortage of electricity from these power stations. Now, the second problem is, in the Krishna River, both Srisailam and Nagarjunasagar are supposed to provide hydroelectricity, and mostly, you know, this hydro electricity is supposed to meet the peak load right up to summer, that is April. Now, the water management in Andhra Pradesh in this Krishna River basin has not been very satisfactory. Usually, this water is supposed to be stored till April, but by December, because of the heavy demand from irrigation, this water is let out. And so by the time we come to January, February, the reservoirs actually, the levels are very low. So there is also a shortage of hydroelectricity. So both ways, hydro shortage and also this gas shortage, Andhra Pradesh has not been able to meet this demand for about 10,000 megawatts. Now, why did the price go up? Very interesting. Because of the shortage, Andhra Pradesh is buying electricity from outside at a fairly high price, because the other from the northern states and western states are buying electricity. In addition, even this natural gas, the price is fixed at a fairly high level. Actually, for India, the price today, which is set for Krishna Godavari gas, is about $4.2 per million BTU. And now this is likely to go up to about $8 to $10 per million BTU, because the pricing formula is such that there will be a hike. So now the question is, after all, Government of India assured Andhra Pradesh of this much of gas availability, of they said that all the power stations, private sector gas power stations, will get enough gas. But today there is a shortage. So what I have suggested to Andhra Pradesh government is, you take up this matter with the Government of India and put up a claim saying that, look, on your assurance, these investments have been made. Now it is for you to fulfill this assurance. Now you give us either gas from some other region, or import gas from you know, the Middle East in the form of liquefied natural gas or whatever, and supply gas at a price which is reasonable. Otherwise, you supply electricity at a price equivalent to what Andhra Pradesh would have paid for a corresponding quantity of gas. Now, this, I think, is being probably taken up by the people of Andhra Pradesh. I've taken part in many meetings in Hyderabad and Visakhapatnam, and we are actually pressing the government. But then the problem today is real. There is a shortage, and summer is coming, and probably power cuts will be imposed, and agriculture, and as you said, students and industry, they're all suffering. And so I suggested to Andhra Pradesh government at least take up some short-term measures immediately by conserving electricity. For example, wastage of electricity on one side. There's a lot of wastage of electricity in our system. And the second thing is most of the appliances we use, air conditioners, the bulbs, fans and all, they're all totally obsolete designs. So Andhra Pradesh government should really take up a large-scale scheme to replace them with more efficient state-of-the-art technology appliances.
So then the other thing is that the household appliances or the government-used appliances?
Household appliances. Household appliances.
I see.
Household appliances. You know, for example, air conditioners are used, air conditioners are inefficient, and also the rooms in which air conditioners are there, they are not properly insulated. Similarly, fans. They're all, many of them are vintage fans which are extremely inefficient. Or refrigerators, washing machines, they're all very highly energy intensive appliances. So slowly, and especially lighting. You know, many places in Andhra Pradesh, people use filament lamps. A time has come when we should go in for compact fluorescent lamps, LEDs, and then the solar. Now, luckily, solar industry is catching up in the south, Karnataka and Andhra. So in many places now, solar lamps and solar systems, solar panels for lighting and solar panels for water heating, they are being installed. So I think this is a program which they should take up on a large scale. It may not give us solutions immediately, but in the next 2-3 years, I think this will have an impact. And the other important area where we can save electricity is the transmission and distribution system, where we lose about 20-25% of electricity because we carry electricity at low voltages over long distances. So the losses are very high. You know, I square R. You know, I is current and R is resistance. So if we upgrade the voltages and invest on transformers, invest on transmission system, the consumers will benefit in two ways. One is the losses will come down. So the cost of electricity, unit cost of electricity will come down. And the second thing is that the quality of supply of electricity will improve. You know, if you have an idea of Andhra, everywhere, in India, for example, everywhere people use voltage stabilizers, uninterrupted power supply systems, and inverters. So these are all investments made by the consumers. If the transmission and distribution system improves and it is strengthened, probably these investments also can be saved and the consumer will benefit in a big way. Now, these are all things which should give us results in the next 2-3 years. And of course, Andhra Pradesh should concentrate on hydroelectricity because we really require electricity for the peak time. There are two peaks in the day, morning and evening, and only hydro storage schemes can meet that kind of peak demand. So this is basically generation and optimization of the generation mix. We should not depend heavily on coal because, one, of course, is coal is heavily polluting. The second is coal-based power plants are displacing. They displace large populations and pollute the surroundings. So we cannot afford really going in on a large scale for coal-based power stations.
So I want to ask a question about that. So the power plants which are proposed, Sompet, Kakarapalli and Komarada, so you are opposing these power plants, right? And maybe you can elaborate on...
Yes, yes.
Because now we are facing a power crisis and maybe a lot of people would say more power plants would solve some of these issues.
See, these Sompeta, Kakarapalli and some of these power stations, they are opposing for two reasons. One is that, you know, they are all located in wetlands. You know, these wetlands actually are seasonally, they are covered with some water. And in the United States, they have got these wetlands. You see, these wetlands actually support thousands of fishing families. They do fishing in the wetlands. Plus, wetlands support a whole lot of biodiversity. And when you destroy wetlands and set up a coal-based power plant there, not only coal emissions take place, but also these wetlands support a lot of greenery. And the greenery acts as a sink for carbon dioxide. When you destroy that, a lot of carbon dioxide actually goes into the atmosphere. And the other reason is, of course, the livelihoods. Many small farmers depend on wetlands. And also it supports, these migrant Siberian birds and all that. In fact, near Kakrapalli, there is a very good bird sanctuary, Teli Nilapuram. Now, what we are saying is that there are laws which prohibit the use of such lands for any industrial activity, Environment Protection Act, and then Forest Act, and then there are wetland rules, Ramsar International Convention for Conservation of Wetlands. So the local people, what they have done is they have actually opposed it because the fishermen are not happy, because they will be disemployed. And in Kakrapalli, there are a number of salt farmers, small salt farmers. So when you have a power plant in this wetland, the level of the land will go up. And I think this year, during the rainy season, about 20 to 30,000 acres of adjacent land got flooded because all this water this actually flooded the area. So it is not just, setting up a power plant. There are many social costs involved. So the communities there all over, in fact, in Andhra, wherever such lands are taken away, they are opposing such power plants. And I must also tell you that in India, there is in 2003, the Electricity Act was amended, a new act was brought in, and they opened the floodgates for these private electricity power plants. Now, I have no objection in principle, against private electricity plants, but in India, what happens whenever you liberalize anything, there is an implicit assumption that the persons who are investing can violate any law, violate the human rights, and nobody should ask any questions. Just to give an example, the number of merchant power plants, merchant power plants are these private coal-based power plants. The Ministry of Environment, in the last 5-6 years, they cleared a massive mind-boggling capacity, generation capacity based on coal, which actually works out to 3 times the capacity projected by the Planning Commission for the year 2032. There is an integrated energy policy document of the Planning Commission, and they made estimates on the basis of certain efficiency norms and all that. And this capacity, which they have cleared, the Ministry of Environment, is 3 times the capacity projected till 2032. And the more interesting thing is, the way they have gone about, and the Ministry of Environment is supposed to actually protect the environment. They have cleared these projects in clusters in India, about 11 or 12 clusters. Each cluster will be a huge pollution cauldron. Say, for example, in Krishnapatnam, in Andhra Pradesh, Nellore district, within 10 kilometers, they've so far cleared 22,700 megawatts. That environment just cannot bear that. And when coal is burnt, especially Indian coal, about 40% is fly ash. And this fly ash has many toxic pollutants, heavy metals, mercury, lead, zinc, cadmium, arsenic, plus radioactive isotopes of uranium and thorium. And some recent research studies in India, in Madhya Pradesh, West Bengal, Punjab, have shown that there is mercury poisoning in the population surrounding these power plants. And in many places, we have found uranium and thorium radioactive isotopes are world over, not only Indian coal. In other coals also, you find radioactive isotopes. So there is a mass upsurge against this kind of pollution, which is toxic and which will have an adverse impact on the health of the people.
Right. So we were actually talking with, just 2 weeks ago, sorry to interrupt, 2 weeks ago we were talking with villagers, the farmers and the activists from Singareni area, and they were saying the unborns and the infants were dying because of this pollution, and so it's, I think the problem is real, the pollution and the effects are a real problem. So I think the coal-based power is, in general, from what you're saying, is not a very good solution for the power crisis. So, and you talked about the solar energy power. We had a lot of shows on solar-based energy, but you get a feeling that it's not enough, especially at the industrial level. It's not, you can set up some panels on the residential areas, but that doesn't solve, right? And other solution that is proposed is a nuclear energy, and we see a lot of fight going on in Kodankulam area. So what are your thoughts about the nuclear plant, and if that's not a solution either, so what, how should we address the power crisis, energy crisis in India?
My basic discipline is nuclear physics, Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. So I have handled isotopes, radioactive isotopes. See, nuclear technology implicitly is risk prone. Now, when Three Mile Island took place, well, people realized it. But then later, Chernobyl really opened the eyes of the people. Fukushima was worse. Probably it will take 40 to 50 years to clean up Fukushima. I don't think we'll be able to clean up fully. Now, there is a nuclear power plant proposal near Visakhapatnam, between Visakhapatnam and Srikakulam. This place is known as Kovada. It's about 6,000 megawatts nuclear power plant. There again, people are unhappy because, one, there are many fishermen there. And they are unhappy because they have been going into the sea for generations. And they don't like the idea of being displaced. And the second thing is, in India, many people on TV screens, and every house has got a TV set these days, they have actually watched what was happening at Fukushima. So there are real apprehensions about nuclear power. And people are questioning nuclear power. And also nuclear power is not as though if you start a power project today, it will come tomorrow. See, in Arriva company, the French company, they are setting up two reactors in Finland. And both these reactors have already been delayed by years and years. And their costs have gone up by almost 2 to 3 times. And ultimately, Finland has decided to not to allow Arriva to set up new reactors. So nuclear power in India, our experience is that they take a long time. And then the price of nuclear power is going to be very, very high, the real unsubsidized power. So indirectly, nuclear power is subsidized because the liability is not passed on to the manufacturers. There is a liability law. And in the United States, this is the case. And I happened to be once chair a committee of the Department of Atomic Energy to determine the price of nuclear power in India. And then we realize that there are many, many cost elements which are not tangible. Say, for example, how do you cost waste management? And then how do you determine the cost of decommissioning? Not much of world experience on that. So there are many, many elements which are there. Plus, an accident is one thing, you know, which is dangerous. But then even low intensity radioactive radiation can cause cancer. And there are many, many studies in Europe and other places. So nuclear probably is not a solution. In fact, recently the Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh made a very positive statement, very welcome statement. What he said was, look, coal is going to be polluting and also it may not last. After all, coal deposits are limited in nature. Similarly, gas. India is not gas rich. We'll have to import it. Then he said nuclear is also, we don't know when it will come. So ultimately, we have to fall back on efficiency on one side. And the other is renewables, either wind or solar. So Andhra Pradesh, I think, has decided to go in a big way. They have set up a committee under the chairmanship of the chief secretary to look into the scope for improving efficiency in the system, supply chain, plus going for renewables. I think that's a very positive sign. I think ultimately world over, whether it is the United States, Europe, Asia, anywhere, I think the solution is not either this or not. I think a time has come when we cannot have an unsustainable way of exploiting nature's resources. Kilowatt hours are going to be extremely costly, so our lifestyles have to change. We have to adopt the lifestyles where we can afford. We must have a system where we will say there will be this much of electricity and no more. Probably that is, I think, a real harsh truth which we have to face.
From what you said, I think the efficiencies and looking at various resources, but that requires a lot of leadership and somebody standing up to maybe huge corporations also, especially if you're in a government and you have to stand up to these corporations. And most of the time it's not easy, as we have seen. Even ministers can be transferred and, you know, just with the pressure of these corporations. So, but if you see on the other hand what is happening, especially if you talk about the tariff that is being put on, a lot of citizens complain that this is because of mismanagement of how the previous government has done, and, you know, they gave out a lot of things that they don't have. And that's when now we are paying for the things that was done in the previous government. So are you hopeful that the governments can stand up to these, and can maybe you can explain more about...
By nature, I'm an optimist. You know, I always quote the example of West Bengal. You know, West Bengal was going through very severe power shortages when I was Union Power Secretary. And then Jyoti Basu, the then Chief Minister, brought in a very competent power minister by name Professor Shankar Sen, who was the Vice Chancellor of Jadavpur University in Electrical Engineering by profession. Now, what Shankar Sen did was, look, I cannot add capacity in 1 year, 2 years. So he said, I'm going to revamp the entire system. So he started with generating stations, transmission and distribution system, and in a matter of about 1.5 years, West Bengal became absolutely comfortable in electricity supply. So that was the time when industries were moving out of West Bengal, but he reversed the trend. So I personally feel that necessity is the mother of invention. Today people realize that it's not easy to, you know, go in for new capacity. New capacity is really megawatts. But Amory Lovins, you know, in that famous book, Soft Energy Parts, he coined the word megawatt. See, megawatt is a saved megawatt. And in my view, a saved megawatt is less costlier, less environmentally destructive, and more benign. So I think we'll have to go in for that, and probably we'll have to go in for renewable megawatts. I mean, there is no escape from that. And I think India has got the capacity, technical capacity, and all universities, IITs must really work on this. Just now I met a batch of engineering college students. And I told them that, look, you must now innovate on electricity. You know, for example, a whole lot of agricultural waste, bio-waste is available in Vizag. And we must have a system of, gasification of biomass and conversion into electricity. Probably every house must have a unit like that. I think we'll have to move towards that. I think this requires a lot of vision and ultimately people's pressure. You know, we believe in people's pressure, civil society.
Right, absolutely. And so one of the issues you are working on, you wrote a book about this also, Will the Sparrows Ever Return? Why is it so much importance we should give to the sparrows? We don't see them. When I was a kid, we used to have a small nest in my house, and I almost, look for them almost every day, but I don't think we see any sparrows anymore.
You see them in Bangalore airport. If you next time when you visit Bangalore airport and you go to the airport restaurant and when you eat, the sparrows will come and attack your plate. Surprisingly, you know, Bangalore airport is full of sparrows. See, I wrote this book mainly as a, I use the sparrow as a symbol. And if you read the book, it's all about the people's movements in Andhra Pradesh. And one of the great things about Sompeta and other things is that today, if you go to the fishing villages of Sompeta and Kakapalli, there the people know about pollution, the technical details and all much better than many government officers. So there is a movement actually, environment movement, livelihoods movement. So this sparrow, we have recently, the World Sparrow Day, we released posters here. And you'll be surprised, in Vizag, we received about 2,000 to 3,000 responses. People saying, yes, I think it's a good symbol, and we're all with you, that kind of thing. So, many people all over the country, they're willing to take part in such campaigns. Only thing is, they require some leadership, some lead. And I hope this this book, I keep updating, is an e-book. I have not printed. But basically, it says sparrow is a symbol. And when I say, will the sparrow ever come back, I'm only talking of... restoring the environment and conservation of the nature.
And you're talking about the civil movements and people's involvement. But we get a sense that these are like waves. Sometimes you get a huge wave and then things seems to settle down and people don't talk about it for a while. And that's what these some of these politicians, they count on. They count on people not sustaining these energies for a long time, because it's very expensive for common people to sustain movements like that, right?
The interesting part of many of these movements is there are two things we do. One is that the technical details of either pollution or environment, that kind of information is given to the people so that we empower them. You know, they know what they're really fighting for. The second thing is, we also tell them what their legal rights are under the Constitution, under the environment laws, under the other laws, what their legal rights are. Now, in Sonpeta, there is an interaction between people who are well-read, you know, doctors, engineers, and traders, and the fishermen who are not so well-read, but then there was a debate and discussion. So this information flow took place. And now this is happening all over Andhra Pradesh and all over India, surprisingly. You know, there was a public hearing held yesterday, I think, 5th, for Mitti Virdi nuclear power plant in Gujarat. And the whole country, people sent their views on this. And the public who went for the meeting, they were fully aware of what they were talking about, what they were questioning and all that. So today, many public people's movements are in India, all over India. You know, they're supported by a lot of information, a lot of technical knowledge, a lot of legal acumen. That's why you find they're going to the courts, and the Indian judiciary is, you know, it's a great pillar of our democracy. So when people file PILs, as they call them, public interest litigation petitions, very often judicial intervention takes place. I think this is a churning that is taking place. It's a very positive way. And people's movements are becoming sustainable. In fact, everywhere you find, people are automatically, you know, even without any external intervention, they're questioning because now they've heard about this, they've read somewhere, TV screens, you know, the media is very, very active in India. And they're competitive, highly competitive. If somebody misses a story, the others will grab it. So everybody is going and presenting it to the people. I think this information revolution, I think, which will make these people's movements highly sustainable.
Absolutely, and we spoke to several fishermen actually from Kodankulam nuclear plant, and they pretty much you ask anybody any question on why they are fighting, they will give you more technical details about the nuclear plants than you ever heard in your entire life. So, what I can definitely relate to what you are saying. And second thing is we just spoke to Dayamani Barla from Jharkhand just yesterday in our show, and she's a tribal, but she's educated and she's motivating other tribals to stand up for their rights. And from what she said, they Mittal still tried to grab their lands, and they were able to successfully fight them off. But more and more corporations are interested in their lands because they're sitting on these mines. So I guess it's an ongoing fight for them, and they leave it. That's their lifestyle now.
But I may tell you for your listeners one interesting thing. There's a place known as Dharmavaram in East Godavari, about 60 miles south of Visakhapatnam. Dharmavaram. No. So there, a private company went. Hello?
Yeah, go ahead.
Hello? There's a private company which went and negotiated for land. So the farmers said, why do you want this land? The private company said, we want to set up a sugar factory. So farmers were very happy. They said, sugar factory means we can raise sugar cane, for which we got a support price from the government. So there is generally prosperity. Plus, their sugar cane, when you cut it, harvest it, their bullock carts can carry to the plants. So the bullock carts have a lot of business. Otherwise, they are not fully utilized. And the third thing is, a sugar factory gives seasonal employment, about 700, 800 youth without much of training. So they said very happily they gave the land. But after that, after taking the land, the private company said, no sugar plant. I'll set up a coal-based power plant, some 300 megawatts or something. So people said, no, we don't want it. We are not bargaining for this. After all, this coal plant, when you burn coal, it spoils the groundwater, pollutes the groundwater, and the fly ash flies all around, and it spoils our health and crops and all that. Now, the question here is that it's not as though people opposed industrialization. They opposed one kind of industry. They preferred another kind of industry. So my thesis is that if people consult, you know, people are fully involved in decision making, you get the best decisions. In fact, in a way, it leads us to the great proposition that more democracy, better development, more appropriate development. You know, this is what Amartya Sen in his book, Development is Freedom, said, that any development activity must widen the choices, not constrain them or limit them. So the process itself must be participative, and the results must enlarge the freedoms. So I think that is the crux of anything to do with development, and we have been campaigning in that direction.
Absolutely. And earlier you mentioned that the private companies are given almost unlimited access to the to how fast they want to extract these mines, not just in coal, but you can see them across the board, and they seem to be have no limits to how much they can extract. And now, from what we spoke to the folks from Singareni area, they are saying underground coal mining, they used to have a lot of jobs, but now they are converting into open cast coal mining, and they don't need so many people anymore because they have huge machineries which can exploit these situations and extract a lot of coal, a lot more coal than what they can do from underground mining. So you can see that why the local people are not satisfied with this kind of development. They are worried that their jobs will go away, and of course the environment is a huge concern for them because their kids are literally dying there.
You know, this mining that you mentioned, surprisingly, you know, 300 BC, Kautilya in his Arthashastra talked about, there's a chapter on mining, the number of shlokas, and they identified some eight minerals and three alloys. One alloy is not yet identified, the rest are zinc and iron, because they used to make weapons out of minerals, they used to get a lot of revenue. Now, Kautilya prescribes in his one of his shlokas, he says that, yes, is a good source of revenue, minerals, but please conserve high-valued minerals because they are limited. That means there is he was talking about a depletion rate, a threshold depletion rate. Surprisingly, the mineral policy of India, the most modern mineral policy of India, recent one about 3-4 years ago, you go through the entire document, there is no threshold depletion rate. You know, you must have a limit because after all your minerals, if you take bauxite, maybe about 60, 70 years. And there must be some limit of paria, otherwise the bauxite resources will be exhausted in no time. So now people are realizing, because iron ore, POSCO for example, you know, they gave a captive mine to POSCO and they allowed POSCO to export to 60% of that. It's supposed to be a captive mine. So I think a time has come when India must have a vision. And after all, these mineral resources are limited. So you must have a depletion, an optimum depletion rate. And you must have scientific methods of using this mineral, and you cannot afford to waste it. So minerals is a very big issue in India. It's Oblapuram, Karnataka, Andhra border. You know, this big case of Oblapuram mining. Then we got this Jharkhand mining has become a big scandal. And the bauxite mining in Andhra, bauxite mining by Vedanta in Orissa. They've all come under public scrutiny, and a whole lot of questions being asked. I think it's an important thing, and it also completely devastates the environment. Open cast mining destroys the environment.
So I want to switch to a different topic, Salwa Judam. I think you are the, one of the members who visited these areas, and had some recommendations, and then you went to the court and so forth. Can you give some background about what Salwa Judam is to our listeners?
You know, these are all Andhra Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Orissa, some of these areas, tribal areas. They are actually the place where there is a lot of extremist activity. And the government is genuinely worried about it. Because extremist activity means the government officials cannot go there and you cannot have much of development. Now, it is like the chicken and egg kind of thing. On one side, if there is no development, genuine development in tribal areas, then that gives scope for extremism. And if there is extremism, no genuine development is possible. So in a way, the government, very often, there are two choices. Either you use development activity to counter this extremist movement, or you resort to some kind of a law and order kind of a method to control it. Now, in the case of Bastar in Chhattisgarh, unfortunately, in this entire thing, what happened, some people were actually given weapons and all that by the government and to fight this extremist movement. In the process, the tribals who are innocent are caught in this crossfire. And many of them were subject to all kinds of harassment, and some of them died and all that. So as an independent initiative, citizens initiative, six of us, we visited this area. Some of them, like for example, Mr. B.G. Vardis, was a very eminent journalist, Ramachandra Guha, a writer, then Nandini Sunda, professor of sociology, a very famous journalist, famous women's activist, Paranakvi. So we all went there. And then at the end of the day, we submitted a report to Government of India and Chhattisgarh government. And we even questioned the extremists, saying, look, you cannot resort to this kind of violence. It is senseless. Now, unfortunately, there was no response from the government. So three of us, Nandini Sundar, Ramachandra Guha and I, we filed a case in the Supreme Court.
And before you continue, I want to ask one more question. Now, so you said some people are given weapons. Who are these people? And
these
what
are
kind
actually
of training,
some of them are some of them are tribals, but many of them are non-tribals. And many of those non-tribals are local traders and all that. Actually, whole of Dantewada, non-tribals are not really supposed to possess land. There is a prohibition on land being possessed by non-tribals. There is an old pre-independence legislation in Andhra and other places. So when these people were given guns, but they did not have any responsibilities. You know, whenever you have weapons and all that, like a police, they have got certain code of conduct, and there is a statutory obligation. But these people did not have any such thing. But then they were just given weapons. So in the process, what happened was, nobody knew whether they were really killing attacking the right people, innocent people, or real extremists, nothing like that. So public accountability was completely lost. And the tribals there were totally in a very, very precarious position. Many of them actually migrated to Andhra districts, Khammam, Bhadrachalam, that area. Koyas, you know, this is a tribe is known as Koya, they speak Telugu. They're all migrating. In fact, we met a number of Koya families migrating. I talked to them in Telugu to try to find out. And they said, look, we are caught for no reason or rhyme. We are being attacked, all these people. Salwa Judam is attacking us. So what we did was, we filed a case in the Supreme Court saying that this Salwa Judam, this kind of a vigilante kind of an army without any responsibilities, without any statutory control, no public accountability, is not constitutional. So the court actually upheld our contention. About 2 years ago, they passed a landmark judgment. And we have also asked the governments to bring back all the Koyas who have migrated to Andhra and rehabilitate them properly with dignity. You see, in the tribal areas, there is an eminent domain kind of a right. Every tribal has an inherent right to his land, forest resources and minerals. And this is actually in Schedule 5 of the Constitution of India. It is actually reflected there. And all laws in India, you know, whatever laws are there in India, before they are extended to the tribal areas, they are supposed to be reviewed, and they are supposed to be adapted to suit the interests of the tribals under Clause 5 of Schedule 5 to the Constitution. 60 years after independence, this has not been done. So the tribals' rights, you know, fundamental rights under the Constitution, special rights under the Constitution, they have not been respected. So our report actually recommended that the government should go all out, reach out to the tribals, restore them their rights. And more than money or anything, I think what is important is to give them their rights, see that their rights are enforced. And I can tell you, the tribals anywhere in the country, they are absolutely self-reliant. They are in a position to manage their affairs very well. They are honest. They're extremely innovative and enterprising. This is my experience. There are a number of real-life examples I've often, I've also, I think, documented in some places. So this case actually, in a way, we got a very, very positive judgment from the Supreme Court. And I hope things will improve with that.
All right, excellent. So one last topic I would like to raise, which is about the ammonium nitrate. And so, about a year ago, I think you have raised a concern in Vizag that there were Russian ships who were dumping thousands of tons of ammonium nitrate in Vizag, and there is no proper place which is safe for these to be stored. So there is no storage facilities, but they are dumping a lot of ammonium nitrate. And this ammonium nitrate can be used as a fertilizer, or it can be used as as an explosive, maybe explosive for mines or even explosives to set up some illegal activities like what we have seen in Dilshuknagar. So could you give some background about this issue?
Yeah. Ammonium nitrate is a dangerous material worldwide. If you see, you know, I downloaded the protocol on ammonium nitrate from the United States, the government instructions, how to handle ammonium nitrate, what precautions to be taken. I got the OECD guidelines on ammonium nitrate. Yes, it is true that Visakhapatnam, a lot of ammonium nitrate comes, not necessarily from Russia or anything, Central Asia, many other countries. And my only campaign, you know, I started the campaign about 4 years ago. And I requested the government to declare this as an explosive under the Explosives Act, and then issue rules for handling it, and then for creating a surveillance mechanism so that every kg, every kilogram of ammonium nitrate is accounted for and properly used. Now, there have been delays, but ultimately the government has notified this as an explosive under the Explosives Act. They've issued ammonium nitrate rules, and now I've been asking them to, you know, set up the GPS, a geopositioning system in each truck that carries, because there are instances of trucks of ammonium nitrate missing in some parts in India. So I said, you must keep track of these things and see that ammonium nitrate is used for genuine purposes, not for illegal or antisocial purposes. So to some extent, there is awareness now. Our campaign is fairly, and you know, ammonium nitrate also can sometimes explode on its own, as it happened in many places, even in US and other cases. I've got some information, past information. So we said that wherever you store it, within 10 kilometers, you should be careful that there are no residential areas, children, schools, and so unfortunately, some violations have been there, but we have been campaigning against that.
Okay, that is... That's a good news. So I guess there's a lot of ammonium nitrate already in anti-solution hands, I guess, right? I think it's possible. And would you say this Dilshuknagar explosion can be related to some of the mishandling of this ammonium nitrate?
No, according to news reports, yes, there are traces of ammonium nitrate there. But then now the government, I think this awareness has come about in a big way. And I think on every front, I think the government is alert and the investigating agencies are alert. I hope things will improve.
Okay, excellent. Sir, you spent a lot of time explaining a lot of things, but is there anything important that I missed out in asking? Maybe you can tell us about that.
No, our campaign, the central theme is how to empower people. So I always say in economics, you know, there is a supply side and demand side. So here also, unless there is a demand for good governance, it will not come. You cannot just expect, you know, the supply of good governance without people's pressure. So what we do is we are basically optimistic. We are not cynical. And the second thing is we believe that once you empower the people, good governance will automatically come, apply pressure, and then we've got excellent wings in the constitution, the judiciary, the executive, the representatives. We also keep a general tab on everything, electoral processes, how to reform the electoral process. I've been in touch with the Election Commission of India. And so in a way, I think ultimately it is the people who decide the future.
And they are very well aware of the consequences and the opportunities that we have.
I think the awareness is slowly going. It's not, I wouldn't call it 100% awareness, but I think these days the awareness has come about and is coming about in a big way.
For some reason, sir, I keep, because we have interviewed Prashant Bhushan, some of what you're saying, it keeps reminding me of my conversation with Prashant Bhushan. So you are aware of him and you're aware of his work, right?
Absolutely. In fact, Mr. Prashant Bhushan contacted me when they were setting up the Aam Aadmi Party.
Oh.
And he wanted me to join the party. But I said, look, I would like to always be outside the party. You know, the famous Mahatma Gandhi statement, very powerful statement, it says that everybody in a country cannot expect to be in power of a seat of authority. But every citizen must have the authority to question those in authority. So that is my adage. So actually what happened was, the Aam Aadmi Party, I'm not a member, but they had a conclave about 1.5 months ago in Delhi. So they invited me. I went there. I took part in the discussions. And I told them that on important issues of public policy, public life, I will support anybody for that matter. I went and called on Anna Hazare some years ago. And so Anna Hazare's famous statement is that we are the Malik and the government, everything is really Gulam, you know,
right.
Public servant. If the Malik sleeps, the Gulam does whatever he wants. So I said, he said Malik must wake up. And so that's the correct way of looking at it. So our campaign is more or less similar. And Right Information Act is a very important tool for us. And people are now becoming more and more aware of that.
Absolutely, but don't you think that one of the biggest issues we have is this lack of credibility or lack of vision in politics, and maybe people like you can do. I mean, obviously you are doing extremely good work by bringing awareness in people, but maybe that's also another area where people like you are needed.
You know, the Indian political, see, one good thing is everywhere there is good or bad, good and bad. But there are many, many good things, many positive things in India's parliamentary democracy. So the very fact that the government, you know, is accountable to the public. You know, they have to make statements in the parliament. And the parliament debates many issues which are heated debates. And the parliamentary proceedings in India are extremely enlightened and very informative. So I think these are all positive signs in India. In a democracy, it's an evolving process. Basically, democracy has to deepen. You know, you have to deepen democracy. That means it must, on every democratic processes must permeate the entire system, which is not the case today, but then it's happening slowly. People like Anna Hazare, this is the campaign, basically. So the public accountability is extremely important. Transparency. You know, today, transparency is extremely important. You know, it's a case where the Prime Minister of India telephoning me and saying, look, I've declared my assets. And then 2 years ago, 2011 February, when I wrote a letter, he telephoned and said, look, I've declared my assets. I asked him. Because if the head of the government discloses his assets, I said, I can ask everybody to declare assets, other functionaries. And he took the, you know, trouble of telephoning and telling me, saying, yes, Union Cabinet, we're all declaring. So this is a very important thing in a democracy, you know, the public accountability. When I had a meeting with Somnath Chatterjee, speaker, when he was the speaker of Lok Sabha, and it was so positive, he convened a big roundtable conference to discuss the parliament and its ways and all that. So that way, India's democracy is a very vibrant democracy with a very positive trends. And today, the composition of the parliament, many people are highly educated, people who are professionals, and the debates are extremely of a very high standard.
You give me a lot of hope and a lot of positive message, but just as a normal guy, I mean, I look at the news and I see, okay, these guys are debating, but right after a debate, there's another scam that comes out, and they debate about it, and the next day, there's another scam that comes out, and it doesn't seem like there's a relationship between, or at least they have a control of what's going on. They seem to have it, have a way of doing these things, and it doesn't seem to impact, you know, the outcome.
No, but I would put it slightly in a different way. The very fact that the scams come out today are because of a highly vigilant press, highly vigilant constitutional authorities like Controller and Director General of India, and also highly vigilant civil society. And probably they are coming out, you know, they are exposed immediately. Anything happens, it is in public domain. And that itself, I think, is a very important symptom of a working democracy. Now, it's a fact that there are scams, and no scam is goes without detection in India today. Probably about 10, 15 years ago, it was not the case. Today, everything is in public domain. And people discuss, TVs discuss, and Parliament discusses.
But the
so I think I would look at the positive side of that.
But the next step,
and all the economic activity has gone up in India, don't forget. The very, you know, economic activity has gone up in leaps and bounds in India in the last 10, 15 years.
But do you think we'll
take... So there is a certain amount of...
Do you think we'll take the next step as well, which is to punish the perpetrators of these scams or various illegal activities?
The first time you find parliamentarians, ministers in jails. First time in India.
Right, but they're getting bail and they're coming out. Of course.
Yeah,
as you said, this is the first time that we are seeing at least this far. But we can only be hopeful, and obviously we are in the right direction.
And also, we got a judicial system. There is a judicial system which is at work, and this is a part of a democratic process. And but the fact that they are arrested, they're put in jail, and first time actually.
Absolutely.
Cases are not closed against anybody.
Absolutely, sir. All right, it's nice talking to you. Before we close, is there anything else you would like to say to our listeners?
No, your listeners, we always like to wish them all the best. And my advice is that if you keep looking for good things, the world will be good. If you look only for bad things, then everything looks bad. So I'm always an optimist. I always look for good things. And I think the positive things should be supported. The bad things should be discouraged. I think that is our motto.
Absolutely. That's what we try to do at NRI Samai, which is to acknowledge the good, because unless we acknowledge what is good, we don't have a right to complain about the bad things. So we try to bring more positive stories and more positive people on NRIs.
And also, don't forget, every one of us has links with NRIs. My son is an NRI, not an NRI, he's a citizen there in Boston, teaches at MIT. So in a way, culturally, there's so many links, and good. I think it's a wonderful thing talking to your listeners.
All right. Thank you very much, sir. You have a good day.
Wish you all the best, all of you. Thank you.
Thank you.